very much related to the topic of our conference and in particular to my talk. So just like yesterday, during the day, the forecast for the whole week, for whole this week, was that it will be cloudy with a little rain. At night, it started raining, so the forecast for the whole next week was the heavy rain. Then in the morning, it's again the forecast for the whole week, more rain, it was that it's foggy with some rain, and now the forecast it will be sunny. You know? So, and this is the official forecast that we have for the week ago, so its forecast changes completely within a single day for the whole week. So this is how it happens, and well, this is of course all related to what we're talking about here. Well, I'm slightly new person in this field of turbulence, so I'm coming from dynamical systems, and also I found out that whatever you learn, if you finished university in mathematics, you remain to be mathematicians. And you finished as a physicist, you remain to be physicist, but somehow deep. But so this relates to how we pose a question. I will be talking, so the instantons and extreme events, which I will be talking about, will be mostly inner motivation of this work, while the questions are really come to the level of mathematically understanding the structure of the solutions that we have. And I'm mostly interested in the question how you can connect directly differential equation to the solution. Well, probably not as a theorem, but at least in a level that we can formalize and feel that it is rigorous. So in that sense, also, it will not so much will be, it's certainly related to turbulence, but it's in the same level related in general to the theory of partial differential equations. OK, so I'll be starting, well, I will be talking about simple models. So this is shell models and one-dimensional models. So the equation in one space dimension, I will, the blow up and related to it instantons will be the main focus. So I'll give some overview of the past results, not being too much, just a general overview to understand what is the instanton, where it may come from, and what we should look at. Then we'll come to the main part, and essentially, the whole idea will be surprisingly based on the Burgers equation. The Burgers equation is Holy Grail for the whole PDEs, in a sense. But then we come to the questions of the blow-up, and essentially we understand what happens with the blow-up before blow-up, but we don't understand what happens with blow-up after blow-up. So that will be the main question. So what happens immediately after blow-up? And then we come to the questions of universality, stochasticity, and so on, and I will finish with a general discussion. Well, of course, this is questions that are for a long time discussed in literature, so I will pass mentioning some references, but I'm not pretending to give the full overview. So anyway, I hope that some of the insight of this talk will be new. So this is, so mainly I will be focused on shell models, and shell models is this kind of equation. Well, it comes down, comes back to the 70s. So we want to, if one wants to put a simple toy model for the flow, the simplest model which takes into account the scaling invariance of the equations is a, and taking down scaling invariance, taking, also remembering that it's infinite dimensional, is a shell model. And shell model is the following. You take the scales as a geometric progression. So it's the simplest way to take into account of the scaling invariance. So the scales are go as geometric progression. This means that the wave number goes as a geometric progression, as a lambda power n, lambda usually 2, not necessarily. And then you construct equations which look like Navier-Stokes. Well, there is acceleration, and there is this quadratic nonlinearity, which mimics the quadratic nonlinearity of Navier-Stokes. Then there is a viscous term, and there is a forcing term. So usually people say it's a kind of Fourier transformed representation, but well, I don't think it's so necessary to say that. But anyway, this mimics Navier-Stokes, and there was some simple equation originally, and then the equation became more complicated. Essentially, the big breakthrough was by considering complex, instead of real numbers, we consider complex numbers. And what was the surprise that the equation started to show statistics even quantitatively similar to Navier-Stokes. So this was a big surprise. Well, maybe this is coincidence, maybe not. But so this is an equation. Well, if you're from different fields, you can say that this equation is simply a one-dimensional lattice when you give a number to each side, and you give a number, well, in this case, it's complex number, and then you assume local interaction. Can be interaction with a neighbor or with next neighbor and so on. Well, you can renormalize it in a way that the local interaction does not depend on n, so it's really one-dimensional lattice with nonlinear interaction. And the question is that if the turbulence appears when you start to excite, put a force to one side, and start to damp it in another side. So some statistics appear. So, and essentially, the nature of these statistics is still essentially an open problem that we're discussing. OK, so this is how the behavior of this shell model look like. The first model that, so I will refer to the first, which was introduced by Desnyansky-Novikov, and the second is what's called Sabra model. So the first model has a behavior like this. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, U1, U2, U3, U4, and so on. You put initial condition forcing. So what happens is when you put very small damping, it collapses, so there is a very clearly seen singularity, and then it comes to the stationary solution, which is called Kolmogorov scaling. Actually, we will see that it's actually nothing else as a shock wave. So it comes to the stationary solution. And in the case of Sabra model, it doesn't happen. Something similar happens in the beginning, and then it starts to be chaotic, and then we have all these non-trivial statistics with moments, anomalous exponents, and so on. So this essentially, the chaotic behavior is what we're interested in. The blow up so first, let's see what happens here. So what happens as a blow up? And blow up was reasonably well understood. So initially, it was understood numerically. So starting with the work from Sija, it was in Nagano, et cetera. So it was mentioned, people could see that the collapse occurs in a self-similar way. So this is clearly seen self-similar way. And then there was a theoretical development made by Dombry and Gilson in 98, which actually showed how we can justify it. So what we do is the transformation essentially is the following. Instead of time, you consider logarithm of time. So you consider tau, which is logarithm of time. And then you also should rescale speeds. And if you rescale, put these two transformations, I will be giving it slightly later. But the main idea is that after rescaling, you have a solution as an asymptotically stable traveling wave. So this is a traveling wave solution. So this is un, this is tau, this is new logarithm of tau. So you have a traveling wave solution, so a very familiar object. And if you now go back to the original variables, you get self-similar form of the blow-up. So this is essentially the idea of the blow-up. It's that it's certain rescaled equation. It gives a traveling wave. You go back, you get self-similarity. Well, the first question is, OK, we have a traveling wave solution. So traveling wave solution is essentially a fixed point solution. Yeah, so it's equilibrium. So it doesn't have to be equilibrium. It can be periodic solution. You know, that there is, can be chaotic attractor. So it can be absolutely different type of attractor. And this is indeed the case. So in several systems, we can have non-self-similar blow-up. So blow-up can be related to the... I give a question later. So essentially, blow-up can be related to the fact that the traveling wave solution in the Reynolds modulus coordinates is not anymore a fixed traveling wave, but a chaotic wave, periodic wave, and so on. And you can see this picture is for the shell model for the natural convection. Well, this is for original variables. This is for renormalized. So you don't see anything, neither in the first picture nor in the second. But this is a blow-up. It blows up. And this blow-up can be connected to the chaotic traveling wave in the original variables. And if you follow some integral characteristics, you see that really it's a chaotic wave with very specific properties. So looking at the chaotic wave, you can see the attractor and so on. So you can see the chaotic attractor for the renormalized system. So this is object that we're used to, it's a chaotic attractor. But now you map it to the original system and you get blow up in a chaotic way. Okay, so before coming to what happens, okay. So another development which was also done in the past was related to the instantons. So what can we do? So in numerically, we can mention that if you see that numerical simulation, how the shell variables change, we will see that there are many similar structures. So they look self-similar, and they look exactly the same, similar to the blow-up. So somehow, the system blows up all the time. So it's for some level, it starts to blow up here, blow up here, blow up here. And this was also approached in the actually rigorously in the work of Damon Dombrink-Gilson in 2000. What they did is they considered renormalized system and added a small noise. They added in small noise to a renormalized system. And now you can use all this machinery. You can write an action, then look for the saddle point, and find the instanton, and so on. So this was done. I won't go into the details, but essentially, what was shown that really instanton exists, and instanton looks like a blow up. You can expand in a small parameter, which is a noise. So really, we have some instanton looking like blow up. So kind of we can think that about this blow up structure as an instanton. The only drawback of this method is that the noise was introduced into the renormalized system, which says that this noise doesn't have so much, it's hard to relate this noise to the physical origin. It's hard to get physical origin of this noise. So what we, so the next work, which was also devoted to this question was by Lvov. Essentially, Victor tried to find self-similar profiles of these structures. And the main conclusion that there were no unique self-similar profile. So the profile was kind of self-similar, not exactly self-similar. So this was given, so he gave a name of quasi-solitons to these structures. Well, instanton quasi-solitons, just vocabulary. But these structures was also studied trying to find a profile. And then there was a next work, which then I tried to do it simply numerically. So no theory, just directly try to picture these solitons numerically. And this is, you can define a specific numerical scheme, how to find this maximum in the curve, and just to see this, to pick up all curves, all these structures directly from a simulation. And surprisingly, it was successful. And what you, the conclusions were that first, the whole statistics of this, of the whole anomalous statistic can be linked to these structures. It's one. Second is that these structures are really self-similar, but self-similar in the statistical sense. So if you take statistics, it's fully self-similar. So you consider just these structures, write moments, and then divide it by the order of the moment, and they collapse to the same length. So it's fully self-similar. But this means that what is not self-similar is a distribution of these structures. And at this moment, it's possible to formulate large deviation principle. Well, essentially what Freddy Boucher was talking in the first lecture, and relate the PDF of these structures directly to the anomalous exponents. So you take anomalous exponents. So this is this picture as everybody is used to. So this is P, and this is zeta P. So we have like a Kolmogorov line, and this we have something like the anomalous exponents, zeta P. So you take a Legendre transform. Then there is also some very simple analysis, and you can match it with the probability distribution function of the of these instantons. So they just come on the top.
What do you mean for probability information? This is the probability to have an instanton of a given intensity at a given time and share it.
Yeah. Actually, it's a bit little more complicated. You take all instantons that was born at the same scale, was born at this scale, and consider the probability distribution for the amplitudes. Actually, since it's self-similar, it doesn't matter where you take it, because it's exactly the same PDF, you just rescale it.
But this you have to measure numerically. You
numerically.
Any way to
you do it numerically. It's possible to do. And it's possible to do it quite with a good accuracy. And also, it's possible to measure all the exponents, and you can match this curve with PDF. They just come one on top of the other by the large deviation principle. So, well, this also shows that this is a structure which can be related to anomalous scaling, though the work is certainly purely numerical. So we don't get directly to the equations. And in this talk, I want to come to get directly to the equation. So now one feature of the shell model, which is totally unrelated to what I said before, is the following. The shell models are often criticized that they're too simple. So they're too simple, and we come from the real space to Fourier space, and we forget most of the modes, come to the discrete dynamics, so there is no way back. Actually, there is a way back. And the way back is shown here. So let us consider one-dimensional equation. So this is a nonlinear conservation law. So the u dt deflux dx plus viscous term plus forcing. So what now, if we consider models of turbulence, and especially models for incompressible turbulence, then nonlinearity is non-local. So we need quadratic non-local linearity with some kernel. So what turns out that if you take kernel in this form, and you do Fourier transform, and then you compute un just at specific points, for this un, you exactly get shell model. Now, if you take the kernel in slightly different form, you get Sabra mode. So so Sabra model is directly equivalent for this equation. So one-dimensional dynamics can be directly linked to the Sabra model rigorously. So that means that the whole game that we do with the shell models actually transports directly to the one-dimensional space. Well, this is not always, of course, happens. For the Sabra model, you need to take lambda, this factor s square root of 2 plus square root of 5, which is 2.028. and everybody takes two. So it's very close to the number. And all, of course, you can relate the inviscid invariance, energy. You can even see the Hamiltonian structure here and so on. Well, this is just to see what happens. So in the simpler model, which is Desnyansky-Novikov model, we had this Kolmogorov law, so the stable Kolmogorov solution. So if you come back now to the original solutions, so reconstruct the continuous function, then make a backward Fourier transform, you see you find a shock wave. So the Kolmogorov. For continuous function.
For continuous function, you get shock wave.
Yeah, for this equation.
Yes.
So you take the shell model.
Because it's integral equation.
It's integral equation. Yeah. You just come back and you see shock. So the Kolmogorov solution is actually shock wave. It's nothing else as shock wave. And you even can visualize this kind of solution. So it blows up and then comes to the constant. So it's just like Burgers. So it forms singularity and then becomes a shockwave. So this is simulations already with some viscosity. So this is a shockwave. The red curve here was a forcing.
What would be the equivalent of the forcing now?
This is a forcing. I put smooth forcing. So forcing is also can be transformed, of course. And now what happens with the Sabra model? For the Sabra model, we have blow up. Actually, blow up for the Sabra model is a bit. I will give a bit more detail, but blow up for Sabra model is a bit is more violent. So what happens is that solution at the moment of blow up already becomes discontinuous. So it's faster. It's not creation of the discontinuity of the not derivative become infinite, but function itself. So the blow up in a continuous form of Sabra model is stronger than in the Burgers. Function, no, in that point, until that point, it was finite. But exactly at this point.
The function itself was finite.
Yeah. Just this one point. Just
it. It's a new complex variable. I think the Sabra is a complex variable.
Yeah, of course, it's complex variable, but you should just define this variable as for the positive k, but there is a negative k. And you take for negative k complex conjugation, then the inverse Fourier transform gives real real line. So it's the original equation is real. So this is a.
Do you have some non self-similar scaling in real space for the real space Sabra model?
This is, I'm going to talk. So about how to find it out. So this is how Sabra model works. So we have blow up, and then immediately something very violent happens. So we understand what happens before that point. And this is this theory of Domberg-Gilson that you transform it to the equation that I will show, and just simply have traveling wave. You transform it back, you get self-similar. What happens after is what I'm trying to talk now. So what happens after? And as I already promised, it will be based on Burgers' equation. So this is most. And so it won't be very complicated. So let's consider Burgers' equation. So consider Burgers' equation in the inviscid limit. So this f now is local u squared over 2. Viscosity was sent to 0 from a positive side. So in that case, we have a unique solution, unique weak solution. So it can have shocks for all times. And this is a solution. Before it blows up, the solution, the classical solution has this form. So there is an initial condition, and every initial condition is propagates along the characteristics until some characteristic merge that we know, and it forms the shock. So if you consider shock at the origin, by changing coordinates, et cetera, so just simply by symmetry transformations, you can reduce the solution to this form near the blow up. So this x equal ut minus u cube plus correction u cube. So everybody who worked with Burgers remembers. So we have this normal form of the blow up, and then there is a correction. So now what we should do? Instead of time, consider log time. So instead of time, we consider log minus e. So tau will be minus log minus t. And then we also need, instead of x, consider log x. So xi will be log x. And instead of u, we consider v, which is renormalized in that special way. So this transformation gives this equation. So you see there is no time here, so it's still translation invariant. But it's non-conservative. Already clearly it's non-conservative because in transformation we put time somehow. So it's not conservative. And what happens is that this equation has a traveling wave solution, which you can recover directly by the substitution here. So we recover traveling wave solution. So we have for v and for xi and tau, we have a traveling wave solution moving as a traveling wave. And it's stable. So this means simply that the moment when you create a shock wave before a creation, it actually, you can map it into the non-conservative dynamical system, which has a fixed point solution, which is traveling wave, and it's stable. So, and you can do exactly the same after the blow up. So what you do, you take log t. So now tau is a log t after the blow up. You do almost, just signs are different. So you take w instead of u, and you come up with a different equation. Only sign here will be different. It's also non-conservative. And you again find a shock wave, stable traveling wave solution. Well, it's shown here, but now, if the before blow up, the traveling wave solution was going to the right, so it was moving from large scale to small scale. So this is how blow up is formed. So the large scale first perturbed, and then you perturb smaller, smaller, smaller scale, and it comes to infinity. And this infinity in tau corresponds just to time zero. And then there is another wave reflected. So another wave getting reflected from infinity coming to the large scales. And it's also stable. This is not shell model so far, but this is what we want to do. This is what we want to do. Yes, this is what. So this wave has, on one side, it has an original blow up state, and another side is shock. So this is shock formation. So this is how the shock is formed. And shock is formed, so the both formation of blow up and formation of shock after are self-similar processes, and you can just map this everyone to its own dynamical system, which is non-conservative, so it has an attractor, and it's fixed point attractor. So which is traveling wave, you put traveling wave back, you get all this picture that we know from the PDE course. Well, of course, nothing new for Bürger's equation, but the question that we are going to raise is the following. So now let us consider separately before blow up and after blow up. So as I said, in every renormalization, we consider logarithmic time. So before blow up, our blow up point is moved to infinity. And we consider dynamical system in log t. After blow up, its blow up point moved to infinity, but to minus infinity. And we consider different log t. So the question, as I already said, it doesn't have to be fixed point attractor. It can be chaotic attractor, it can be periodic attractor, and so on. Well, I already mentioned that it can have before blow up. We can give examples of shell models where the attractor is not fixed point, so it can be periodic, quasi-periodic, chaotic wave, etc. And you can see it in natural convection shell models. Then we have it. Recently, we found them in helical Sabra models, and also they're available in MHD models. So the student here, Guilherme, is working on this. But essentially, this is just how the blow up is formed. Actually, this is somehow maybe linked philosophically to the question of blow up in differential equations. So the blow up, if a blow up is chaotic, you won't see it from numerical simulation. Just directly, you don't see blow up in this picture. So you really need the machinery to capture it somehow binary normalization. So blow up can be chaotic, can be quasi-periodic and so on. But anyway, this is just how the system behaves before the blow up point. And in all the cases, it's universal. Even if it's chaotic, it's universal because it's just one solution, one chaotic attractor, which describes asymptotic behavior. Yeah, just one solution, which means that when it comes to blow up, your properties of this solution are asymptotically are determined by this attractor.
You don't know how to prove.
Well, of course
it's
you. Well, but proving that there is a chaotic attractor is something which is usually impossible. Yeah. No? But anyway, well, I'm not. In all this program, I'm not interested so much to improves, but I'm interested to come. To bring the object that we don't understand to a level of objects that we understand better, like car attractors. So this attractors we understand. Because this becomes essentially finite dimension, finite dimensional dynamical system phenomenon. So it's a chaotic attractor. You can even calculate the dimensions. So dimension is finite of the attractor. What is really interesting is what happens after blow up. Why it is interesting is because the point where the blow up starts is at minus infinity, which means that every time, so the time in the renormalized coordinates, the time that this renormalized system spends from blow up to any time, any finite time, is infinite. Because it was in tau, the system filled infinitely long evolution. Right? Which means that at every fixed time, you get, well, let's see what does it mean. So as I said, that the solution doesn't have to be fixed point. So the one of the examples, it was for the Gladzer shell model. And this is exactly the Sabra Ogoi model if you take purely imaginary speeds. So it becomes real. And it's known that this system is not, it doesn't have any anomalous exponent and so on. So it's simpler in a sense. But it's already not as Burgers. So what happens is that this renormalized system, and the renormalized system I can probably show, let's go in front. So renormalized, this is renormalized. Will be the renormalized shell model. So this is just linear term, extra linear term, just exactly the same way as for the Burgers. And these linear terms make it non-conservative. So what happens is that the attractor in that system after the blow up is a periodic solution. So this is shown, this is periodic solution shown here. So this is time, and this is n minus time over period. So this is a kind of, it's shown in a frame moving together with a wave. And if you will look carefully, then this part is exactly as this part. So it's periodic. So what does it mean? It means that, but shell model is only lives on integer n. So in order to get a solution after the blow up, so this crazy stuff on the right, you need to cut it along n equal integer. And if you cut this picture at n equal integer, you get this, all these kind of curves. And you get specific solution. Now, the next question, you cut it depending. So there is a, this solution is time invariant. So you can make a shift in forward or backwards. It will be still solution. So this cutting is actually depends on how you regularize system at the viscous layer. And what is shown is that if the viscosity is represented in this form, now you can send psi is a parameter. Chi is a parameter between 0 and 1. And n is an integer. You can send it to infinity. So the solution that you get here is only the limit depends on this number. And it's absolutely different solution depending on the number. So this is what's shown here is a time. This is U3, U4, two shell speeds. Depending on how you send viscosity to zero, you get different solutions, and then form this one-dimensional picture. So So there is a non-unique limit, but you know this limit. You can figure out what is it. The limit depends on, actually, for specific very small viscosity, you can pick up solution, and it will be different for different viscosities. What is much more interesting happens is if the solution now not, so the, remember the wave now, it's after blow up. So the wave comes backward direction. So it comes from small to large scales. So what happens if the wave is chaotic? And the wave is chaotic in the Sabra model. If the wave is chaotic, as I said, tau is a log t. So time at the blow up corresponds to minus infinity, which means that any solution, well, of course, you regularize somewhere very far away, but by very small viscosity somehow. But any solution that you observe at final time make an infinitely long evolution in the renormalized time, which means that any small perturbation that you put here will, you only see attractor. At every finite time, you only see the full attractor. You can't see the particular solution. Because any particular solution, if you put arbitrarily small perturbation, it will be destroyed. So this means that physically, after blow up, the only way to formulate the physically relevant solution is taking attractor of the system. So stochastic. So we formulate it stochastically. Essentially, I can probably draw the picture. So here is the time. This was blow up. And now we take tau equal log t, which means that this point goes to minus infinity. So any evolution here will become chaotic attractor on that part. And any finite time corresponds to infinitely long evolution. By the way, I'm coming soon to this stochasticity. What directly, this is to what Grigory Falkovich was talking about, separation of curves. So here, the separation curve is at infinite dimensional dynamical system. So it's separation of curves is exponential of Lyapunov exponent by tau. So if you remember that tau is log t, it will be, it become power law. So here it is explosive. And it directly follows from finite dimension. Shell model, Shell model. Burgers, we know that Burgers, this is a fixed point solution. It's traveling wave. So if it's chaotic, we immediately have this situation.
Lambda's a fixed or the different?
No, lambda is fixed. It's Lyapunov exponent for this attractor. It's main Lyapunov exponent for this attractor.
It's different from different Shell models?
Well, of course. Well, even the Sabra model has a parameter. So you change parameters, it's different. So now I just show how this is realized directly on in a Sabra model. So up to now, it was general discussion. Well, this is exactly the Dombrink-Gilson scheme of 1998. Well, I probably skipped the details. But anyway, you have a Sabra model. You can, well, this is just reminding that it can be written as a Burgers-like ODE, but with non-local quadratic term. And renormalization is just you put some change of coordinates, which is essentially similar to what I did by taking logarithms. And you end up with a system which has a steady state traveling wave. So it's stable traveling wave. And you can see it numerically. It's stabilized very, very fast. Now you come back, you get this self-similar solution before the blow up. So this is what we know, and this is what, which is behaves very nicely. Now we come to the blow-up point. When we come to the blow-up point, we have the exactly self-similar solution. So this is the kn power something. Well, it's actually interesting to see the continuous representation. So what you can do, you can construct back this U of KT, make a backward Fourier transform. So what this solution means in a real space, so X of U is this one, this stuff. So this is exactly the solution which corresponds to the blow up. So this X power beta minus 1 sine X, and beta is very close to 1. So it's almost shock, a little stronger than the shock. So it's 0.064 stronger percent stronger than the shock. So you just see it. And now then, next dynamics is developed from this solution. This is renormalized equation. This is a transformation to this renormalized equation. So it's exactly Essenberger's. Only that we all know very well that it is chaotic. So the behavior is chaotic. And if you, for example, consider the standard deviation of the linear term, because you should you put time in relation un with a renormalized wn. So when you take time derivative, the one of the derivatives comes from this factor. And since this factor depends on time, it's clearly the new system is non-conservative, because your transformation depends on time. Well, the first check how we do simulations. We should renormalize this at small scales, and we put a very, very small viscosity, 10 power minus 15. But as I said, in order to see attractor, we need a small perturbation in the beginning. And this small perturbation is important. So we need to put perturbation into the renormalization. So I slightly perturbed the shell, one of the modes deep in the viscous layer. So I put 1% perturbation, random perturbation. So I perturb only very, very, very small scale. And then see what happens with the solution. And for the, this is standard deviation for the real part of the of this renormalized coordinates. You see directly that there is a wave, stochastic wave is forming, because this is stochastic property. So you see the stochastic wave forming. It actually looks very similar to the Burgers. So Burgers is like this. And this is for standard deviation. So there is a wave coming from small scales to large scales. And this is the direct PDFs. So this is just looking at PDF. So we know that it should, what I told before is that at after finite time, which is infinite renormalized time, we see the attractor. And this is the attractor which is moving with a constant speed. So we have a stochastic wave moving with a constant speed, and we can really observe it. So this is a PDF, and this is written for the shell 10, 15, 20, and we see that exactly the same kind of PDF is moving. So this is a stochastic traveling wave solution moving from small scales to large scales. It moves with a constant speed, with the same shape. Well, that's it, and with a constant speed. So and it has a, in front of it, it has a deterministic state. So this thin line means that it's deterministic state which was at the blow up. And at backward, it has a chaotic state, a chaotic stochastic.
So what it corresponds to the original cell variables?
Good. So now I will, next picture probably answers your question. So how to come back to the original variables? What we can do is, instead of the speeds, we can consider increments. So this un divided by un minus 1, and also there is some phase. So it was comes back to the idea of Kolmogorov about considering increments of the speeds instead of the speeds themselves. And it was also pushed forward by Beferali, Parisi, Inc., and so on. And the original idea of Kolmogorov that in the statistically stationary turbulence, this distribution of this quantity will be universal. So what we have, and now we can write the same way, but for this variable. So this is, in a sense, in terms of the original variables, but not in U, rather than in increments. So this is a wave, stochastic wave which comes, and in these variables, it's stochastic traveling wave, which has a constant state in front, constant state behind. So we have a deterministic constant state in front, and stochastic constant state behind. So it's just traveling wave that we're all used to, only it's written for the probability measure. And now, if you see what is the constant state behind, and you can, first of all, you can check that it's constant state. So these black curves are taken from different pictures, so they all show this constant state. And you can put on the top, this red line is a PDF for the same increments taken from the stationary turbulence. You just take stationary turbulence, compute these increments in the inertial interval, and you see that it's exactly the same, both for increments and for phases. So what I'm telling that this is after blow up, we see the formation of the wave, of the stochastic wave, which in front has a deterministic state, and back it has constant stochastic state, which is exactly Kolmogorov turbulence. So this is the way how the Kolmogorov turbulence emerges from the deterministic state to the large scales. And it's, well, and it's universal, because it's just one solution.
You mean Kolmogorov 62, not 41?
Well, Kolmogorov, it's Kolmogorov 41 taken from Kolmogorov 62. So the state is really Kolmogorov, well, not Kolmogorov, it's the with, so this is the statistics for the turbulence that we do have. It's not from that Kolmogorov predicted. It's what we do have, but the idea that comes to this constant state comes from Kolmogorov 62. But it's not from the theory how he derived the distributions, but from just from the assumption that the increments are universal. Okay, so now I'm coming to general discussion. Just to conclude, I would like to oppose, in some sense, the Lagrangian spontaneous stochasticity that is quite widely discussed for last decades to the stochasticity that we have here. So Lagrangian stochasticity, comes back to Richardson's experiment in the 20s. So what he did, he was taking balloons and letting them go to the turbulence air. And then he saw that the two balloons that you let it go, they separate in a power law. They don't separate exponentially. They separate as power law. And this can be put into the really rigorous form. So there is, this picture is from this review of Falkovich, Kalecki, Vergasola. And what we see is, if you consider the Brownian motion for the particle with the velocity field which is prescribed, and the velocity field is non-Lipschitz, so it's rough non-Lipschitz velocity field, we know that, well, already if the velocity field is non-Lipschitz, we know that solution is non-unique. This is ordinary differential equations. But now we can add a small stochastic term, and send this stochastic term to zero. So we put stochasticity and remove it in a limit. So what happens is that the distance between the nearby curves grow as a power law, and the arbitrarily small point will simply, if you put a paint at a small point, it will become a cloud. Essentially, the difference between this and the dynamical system chaos is that the cloud opens up as a power law. It doesn't open up as exponential. Very similar thing happens here. So after blow up, the speed, which was so time here vertically, and this real part of the tense velocity. So the, at the blow up, it was deterministic, and it opens up, it becomes stochastic at future times, spontaneously. And also it happens in somewhere, some type of power law. So, but there is a difference. The difference is, first of all, here it, the whole picture was based on the fact that you can write this kind of Feynman-Katz representation for the viscous equation. So you substitute viscosity by the Brownian motion and then consider solution at the as an average. So viscosity here is a fixed parameter. Here you cannot get anything like this in this formulation. You need to put a small noise at the small scale, or a noise at the small scales. It is essential because you need to petty up your solution so it grows up to the interactor. I will show how small it is, but you need to put a small noise. So essentially, this this is not only not only physical conclusion. This is mathematical conclusion because this shows that we need to regularize the system in a slightly different way. We should not put viscosity and send it to zero. We should put viscosity and small noise, or which is leads to the same result. You should you can put, for example, some random perturbation to viscosity itself. So there should be random term into in the renormalization term. At the same time, you don't need to put any stochastic component in the large scales. Well, this is simply a repetition of the whole stuff. I finished it later, so still I have a five minutes. So this is essentially what I just told. The difference between Lagrangian and stochasticity that we have here, you can also see in a very simple example. So let's consider ordinary differential equation. So R dot equal R 1/3. This mimics Lagrangian trajectory in a velocity with a Kolmogorov scaling. And well, this is a solution. And the solution starting from zero is non-unique. So all every black curve is a solution. So essentially, you have non-unique solution. You have a whole span of solutions. But however, you don't know which solution you should take and which solution is better, which solution is worse. Essentially, you can derive, you can introduce here arbitrary probability distribution, and it will expand. So there is infinite number of also probabilistic solutions. In our case, it's not the case. In our case, all these non-unique solutions, they mixed up. They fully mixed up and create a unique stochastic solution. So the stochastic solution is unique. This is unique and universal. So this is a message. So we need not only non-uniqueness due to non-Lipschitz velocity, but we also need chaos. And if you put chaos together with non-uniqueness, it can give a unique solution as a probability measure. So essentially, I think this is probably the main message that for Sabra model, what happens after blow up is non-uniqueness and chaoticity together, they force the solution to behave as a probability measure. And this probability measure is, it does not depend on the regularization. It doesn't depend how you perturb it here, because it's an attractor. I would like to come back to the old references. So this is, well, this is, of course, was discussed in various papers. So one paper I would like to mention is Leitz Kreichnand, which is exactly called predictability of turbulence flows. So this is what we all know. The time required for an arrow to reach wave number k, so large wave number from large scale, so small wave number from a large, from high wave number, is this quantity. It scales as k minus 2/3. So if you want to reach the larger scale, you should put k1, so this will become constant. So this means that from small, this is what just Falkovich was talking, that the correlation of small scales to large scales actually does not depend how far on how far they are. The next paper was by Ruel, which is microscopic fluctuation in Stubbins in 1979, he actually computed the other question. So this is related to the transition from noise from viscous scale to large scale. Now, Rell, he considered how the noise is created at the viscous scale. So he actually came to the conclusion that you need just 10 characteristic small scale times to create, to fully turbolize the viscous scale. So combining the two, you can say how, you can conclude on how really stochastic your solution of the Sabra model. This means how precise should be your initial data in order to be able to predict large scale behavior at just one turnover. So you want just one turnover, and you know what the vortex is here or here. And how precise should be your initial data in order to do it? And combining these two, conclusions, you get that your initial conditions should be precise to the exponent minus square root of Reynolds. And if Reynolds is, for example, 10^8, your initial data should be precise to 10^-440. So which means that essentially it's not even a butterfly effect. It's a quantum perturbation. One molecular is sufficient in order to big vortex will be instead of one place in the other. So this is extremely, extremely strong perturbation, which means that essentially the physical way to look at the solution is a stochastic distribution. Well, I think nobody ever had doubt about this. But what is shown here is that in order to have the ensemble, we don't need large scale forcing. We don't need large scale random initial condition. We only need to regularize it in the right way. And then you get the full stochastic solution. OK. Thank you.